Welcome to the mathematical part of this module, where we're going to talk about stories and theorems. The theorems will be the major part, but the stories will also not be a negligible part. So I would like today to give an introduction about my terminology, about some basic ideas that I'm going to use, and somehow to familiarize you with what we're going to do during this series of lectures. So, first of all, how are stories and theorems are related? Because from a general point of view, somebody will say that stories or myths and theorems are totally unrelated things. And somehow they belong to exactly anti-diametric regimes. What I believe is that stories and theorems are very, very closely related. And the reason is that there is always some obstacle which is behind both a story and a theorem. And this is the unifying thread that we will try to explore in this series of lectures. So, let me start by very briefly saying what a theorem is about. I suppose a story, you know what it's about. So, in mathematics, we need theorems because the whole body of mathematics is built on some kind of assumptions. It is doxastic initially. So what we need is to have some kind of definitions, then we need to have some axioms, and the theorems are the deep part of the abstraction. And since I'm talking about abstraction, mathematical thinking is based exclusively on abstraction. And of course, it is combined with physical thinking in many cases. So, the idea is that mathematics, physics, and I would say architectonics and philosophy, they form a whole. They are not separated. Their separation came through for systematical reasons. But the ideas, they have a common thread. They are based, first of all, on this notion of the inconceivable, so that you have to wonder about things that you cannot access directly. So that's the first thing, to start wondering and then to locate some kind of obstacle which is there, and then to start wondering around it. So it's this idea of circulation. And basically, this is the method that we are going to follow in the explication of the theorems. So I'm not going to go to the proofs of the theorems, but I will try to take the basic ideas and to try to abstract them on a level where somehow they become more universal. They become more interesting, especially for architects. And then the idea is to come back at the level of the initial problem and see what we have gained through this procedure. So I talked about the notion of invariance. I didn't talk about invariance yet, but invariance is the objective of abstraction. So, abstraction, first of all, how can we visualize it? I mean, a useful thing is that it's very easy to visualize a circle. And then you can imagine a series of circles around it, which are expanding. So there is a radius which is expanding. And what you make out of it is a kind of a filter. We try to capture the notion of percolation through this visualization. And the idea is that if you have a problem which will lead eventually to a theorem, what you need first of all is to abstract what is the deepness of this problem. This means that you have to get rid of all the irrelevant details, because the irrelevant details, they obstruct you, they bother you, and they do not allow to see the depth of the things. This is the method that was first developed by Archimedes. I would say he was the first master of abstraction, having this type of approach that I like to think of as a kind of obstacle-oriented approach, not a target-oriented one. And that's a big difference. And it will be very dominant in the way of thinking during this course, because I do not start from predefined targets. Every theorem has a kind of obstacle that we have to locate first and then to see how we can proceed. I come back to the issue of abstraction and I give you this picture of the expanding concentric circles. The idea is that in every circle, we try to get rid of more and more things. So this is how percolation in my mind works. So we try to make a filtering out of what can be more universal and not based on the particularities of a specific problem. So we try to see through the obstacle, but because we cannot directly go and hit the obstacle, we have to start circulating around it, but in a way that this circulation will give something in the end. So first of all, it will not be self-referential. It will be logically consistent. And also, it will try to build some kind of spectrum. This is a very important idea, this idea of spectrum in my approach. And I would call it, as a slogan, a spectrum is a screen. It's like the screen that you see me now, where you can not only see my picture and the video, but you can also hear my sound. So a screen is a visual thing, but it's also an acoustic thing. And look behind me, you have the illusion of a three-dimensional rigid space, three-dimensional rigid geometric space. But what you actually have, it's just a digitalization of some area. So this is your digital geometry. It's not the rigid geometry that you think it exists around you, but it's a kind of a digital abstraction of the geometry that you know. Now, how is this possible? I do not mean technologically and technically, but what is the abstraction behind it? And this is something that we have to be very careful and we have to focus on. Because it touches exactly the essence of the notion of a partition spectrum. The idea is that you need the notion of area, which you take from geometry, but you uplift it from the geometric level. So you abstract it, you get rid of all the irrelevant details, and the details in this case are the details of space, of geometric space. And then you encode it digitally. In order to achieve this, you need to be able to do abstraction. And the abstraction in this case, it's a kind of partition spectrum, which is based on this idea of homology, which is a topological notion, the idea of homology. Basically, with homology, you try to build equivalence classes, and out of these equivalence classes, you give rise to a spectrum. So a spectrum is something which consists of basic blocks, so the pixels, for example, and all of them, they are mutually exclusive and jointly exhaustive. Now, in a single block, there can be millions of things. So, but in order to have access to a block, you just need to know a representative. So in this perspective, the idea of a partition spectrum is the most economical thing that you can do, because you can reduce a kind of infinite complex problem in terms of a spectrum which will consist of a finite number of blocks, and then you are able to use a single representative from each block, and you can build a theory which is made out of theorems using just this partition spectrum. But this notion of spectrum is not a new idea. It is rooted in the conception of mathematics. It was called epiphania. So it is what makes things possible to appear in the first place, to appear in some form. But this form doesn't have to be geometric. And you do not have any initial structure on this thing. So what you need is a way to be able to index and to be able to form blocks or cells or classes of things which are equivalent with respect to some particular criterion. And this is how you access the complexity that is posed by some obstacle. So with abstraction, the idea is that moving gradually in this series of concentric circles from the inside to the outside, we filter out things and so on until we reach some level where we see that something remains invariant. And this is the important stage. A partition spectrum always goes together with something that remains invariant under the conditions of the equivalence. Having grasped now something which is invariant, we are able to wrap up again the spectrum and move to the level of our initial problem. And this is what makes the conception of the basic idea of some theorem possible. It is not the proof. The proof is the technical step which consists of a series of deductions that you formulate in this way in order to be concise and to be presented in a way which is somehow axiomatic. I will explain what is the purpose of it from my perspective. I think there is also an economy principle at work here. Basically, the idea is that this is the most economical way to transfer some truth, because a theorem, if it is established, it's about some truth. How you can transfer this idea into historical time? So you need a kind of capsule to encapsulate this idea, okay, so somehow to get it in a vacuum, and like this it can be transferred through historical time. And this is the method of the axiomatic approach. But I will not focus on the proof itself from a deductive point of view. This is not our objective in this series of lectures. I will try to follow an inverse approach, which is based exactly on the idea of conception of a theory. So how it is possible to percolate an idea which is behind something which possibly will lead to a theorem, and is based on the notion of some invariance. And of course the notion of a spectrum, these two things go together. Invariance always refers to a particular spectrum. So, just to recapitulate this very briefly, is that mathematical thinking, where the theorems I'm going to talk about in the sequel refer to, are about abstraction and about being able to transfer the truth of a theorem through historical time. And in order to achieve this, as I said, you need to be able to have an axiomatic framework to which we will not focus in this course. But you need something else as well, and this is the idea of invariance, which goes together with the method to be able to build a spectrum. And we will focus in particular in the method, with many examples of how it's possible to build spectra. Spectra not only visual, but also acoustic, digital, and even more abstract than this. Now another idea with which you have to familiarize yourself is that my approach will not be strictly based on mathematics. I will use a lot of physical thinking as well, and a lot of philosophical thinking. This will go mainly to the conceptual discussion of theorems, and in particular, I will use mechanical arguments from classical mechanical point of view, but even from a quantum mechanical point of view. In this case, I will not restrict myself to dry mathematical propositions. This is not our objective here. The thing is how we can get some basic ideas, which refer to theorems, not for applications, although of course they can be applied, but as I said, the approach is not target-oriented. So it's not targeted to get to learn theorems and to apply them immediately in fields like in architecture, or in economy, or in whatever. So there are no basically applied mathematics. Mathematics is a unifying body of things. You cannot dissect it into pure mathematics and to applied mathematics. So it's a unifying body which is alive. It's a body which lives in the physical world. So it is not dry, it is not a skeleton, it is not only logic, which plays a role, especially formal logic, but also how it interacts with physics and actually with architectonics, because initially architectonics and mathematics were inseparable. If you see in the past, but even there are present cases, that architects and mathematicians were not only collaborating together, but they were working together in projects. Because a good architect who wants to give a kind of novelty in his work, he needs to be able to do abstraction. So he needs to be able to think mathematically. He needs to be able to decode theorems. And this is something that we will try to focus on very soon. So see you next time.